You're watching Vue Mastery's Vue 3 Reactivity course. And why should you care about this course? Well, you're going to be learning about Vue 3 design patterns, how it's designed under the hood, which may help you create more powerful applications. You'll also get improved debugging skills, because the next time you do a stack trace through your code, maybe something's going wrong, you'll recognize some of the underlying functions in Vue 3. Also, the way that Vue 3 is built is that Reactivity is a separate module. So you can use this code in new and creative ways that you couldn't before with Vue 2. And lastly, if you want to contribute to Vue, you'll now understand the Vue 3 source code a little better. The way Vue 3 handles reactivity is completely different than Vue 2. So if you've seen my reactivity lessons in the Advanced Components course, this is all new content. You're going to want to stay tuned. Also, I need to make sure that you are familiar with the basics of Vue, as well as basic JavaScript. Now that we got that out of the way, let's jump into the course. And it starts by taking a look at a simple Vue app and a simple template. If we load up this component and then our price changes, Vue somehow knows to go and update the template here and here, and our computed property, which updates the template here. So the question is, how does Vue know how to update all the things? And specifically, Vue's reactivity, because this isn't how JavaScript usually works. If we have price and quantity, and we have a total which multiplies them together, and we print out the total, and then we update the price, total is still 10. It doesn't get updated, there's no reactivity here. In the first two lessons of this course, we're going to build a reactivity engine from scratch. This is useful because we'll build it in the same exact way that Vue 3 does reactivity. We'll solve this problem step by step. And first, we need to ask, how can we save the total calculation so we can run it again when price or quantity updates? So let's think about this for a second. This piece of code, we want to be able to save it in some sort of storage. Then we need to run it, and then later on, we want to run this stored code again. And we might have more than one piece of stored functionality. So let's write this out again, and this time set our total calculation in an anonymous function and store it inside of effect. This is the code we want to save. Then we'll call track when we want to save the code we have inside of effect. We'll run this effect to calculate the total for the first time. And then sometime later on, we'll call trigger, which will run all the code that I've saved inside of our storage. By the way, the names I'm using here for effect, track, and trigger are the same names you'll see in the Vue 3 reactivity source code. Let's go ahead and use an arrow function here to shorten our code. To store our effects, we'll use a dep variable, which stands for dependency, and it's a new set. To track our dependencies, we will add the effects to the set. The reason we're using a set here is because a set does not allow duplicate values. So if we try to add the same effect, well, it won't add it twice. And then our trigger function will go through each of the effects in our storage and run them. So if we run this code, our total is currently 10. If we change our quantity, we can then see that our total is still 10, but then once we run trigger, it reruns our total calculation, and now our total is 15. Often our objects will have multiple properties, and they each need their own dep, or set of effects. So how can we store or have a dep for each of our properties? Here you can see we've encapsulated price and quantity into a product object. Each of these needs its own dep. A dep is basically a dependency, which is a set of effects that should get rerun when values change. As we saw, it's of type set. Each value in the set is simply an effect that we need to rerun, like our anonymous function, calculating total. To store these deps in a way to find them later, we're going to create a deps map. It's a map where we store the dependency object for each property. A map has a set of keys and values. We'll use our object's property name as the key, such as quantity or price. Our values in this case will each be a dep. Let's code this up, starting with our depths map. Our track function is first going to get the depth for this particular property. The key here will either be price or quantity. If it doesn't have a depth yet, let's go ahead and create one and store it in our map under the key. And then we'll add this effect. And remember, since it's a set, it won't add the effect again if it already exists. Our trigger function will first get the depth for this key. If it exists, it will go through each effect and run them. Now back to our original code with our product, total, and our effect. Here we're going to call track quantity, which will store the effect, and then we'll run the effect. If we run this in our console, our total is now 10. We can set product quantity to 3. In order to run total again, we run trigger and specify the property, which is quantity. The effect was run and the total is now 15. Great. Great! So now we have a way to track dependencies for different properties. But what if we have multiple reactive objects, such as a user object? So far we have a depths map, where we store the dependency object for each property, and each of those properties has its own depth with effects to rerun. We need some other object over here, maybe a map, where the keys somehow reference our reactive objects, such as product or user. This is where we'd store the dependencies associated with each reactive object's properties. In Vue 3, it's called a target map, and it's of type weak map. A weak map is simply a map where the keys are objects. So let me show you what I mean. If we create a weak map, we can then set the key equal to our product, and our value maybe just a string called example code to test. To get that value, we would call get, and again, send in an object. And it would print out example code to test. This is just an example to show you how weak maps work. Do you get it? At this point, I was wondering, why does Vue 3 call this target map? And don't worry, it'll be clear in the next lesson. So now let's code this up, starting with our target map, which is for storing the dependencies for each reactive object. Then in our track method, we'll first get the current depths map for this target, which in our case will likely be product. If it doesn't exist yet, we'll create a new depths map for this object. We'll then get the dependency object for this property, which might be quantity. If it doesn't exist, let's go ahead and create it as a new set. And then we'll add the effect to the dependency. Then in the trigger function, we'll check to see if this object has any properties that have dependencies. If no, we can just return from the function immediately. Otherwise, we'll check if this property has a dependency, and if it does, we'll go through each effect and run it. There's more to our code. Remember, we have our product, our total, and effect. This time when we call track, we'll send in the product and the quantity. If we execute this code, our total is currently 10. We'll change the quantity to 3. Our total is still 10 because we need to trigger sending in the product and the quantity property. And now our total is updated to 15. Because it ran our effect. Let's look back at our diagram one more time. Our target map is where we store the dependencies associated with each reactive object's properties. Depths map is where we store the dependencies for each property. And dep is a dependency which is a set of effects that you get rerun when values change. So we have a way of storing our different effects, but we don't have a way of rerunning our effects automatically. That's the second big piece coming up in the next lesson.